Welcome, action fans, and thanks for joining us for another edition of All 90s Action, All the Time. As we wrap up our short Val Kilmer season, I'm your host, Scott Murphy, and on this final Kilmer episode, we will be looking at 1997's The Saint. As always, I am not alone in dissecting this one. No, alongside me, you know who he is, I have my regular co-host, one third of the Bloodhound Picks podcast, screenwriter, and a man who looks real sinister rocking a cane, it's Mr. Craig Draheim.
It's still early, so you want to get some coffee?
yes, Craig. I think we should all do that.
And that's about as good of an accent as he gets. Not to even toot my own horn, because it was a horrible German accent.
When I was watching that scene, I kept thinking of, because I know you've seen the show, I kept thinking of Steve Pemberton's in the League of Gentlemen character. You know, I kept expecting them to be like, Eines klar. But that is not all. It's not just Craig. As returning for his second appearance on the show, we have fellow podcaster, host of the £1 Movie Podcast, and a man who just today performed his third miracle. It's Mr. Wayne Saunders.
Hello, Scott. Hello, Craig. I was going to go for the German accent, and then Craig ripped it. Second episode, he's done it to me.
Everybody loves the German accent.
It's the best thing in the film. We only watch it for that moment.
Yeah. I can't remember that character's full name, but I do remember his first name is Bruno for some reason.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Of course it is. Can't be nothing else.
Yeah. Now, on to today's film, The Saint, which was released on April the 4th, 1997. It was directed by Philip Noyce, who's had an interesting career. His credits include the likes of Patriot Games, Clear and Present Danger, which are both action thrillers like this, but also critically acclaimed dramas like Rabbit Proof Fence and The Quiet American, both of which came out in 2002, and chillers such as The Bone Collector and Dead Cam, and a whole bunch of other stuff. It's really interesting digging into his filmography. It was written by Jonathan Hensley, whose most notable screenwriting credits include the likes of Jumanji, Die Hard with a Vengeance, and Armageddon. Although he gets a sole story writing credit and part screenwriting credit, but his original screenplay was rewritten by Wesley Strick, whose most notable credits include the likes of Arachnophobia, the Martin Scorsese Cape Fear remake, and he wrote several episodes of the Man in the High Castle TV show. Review-wise, it is currently sitting at 6.2 out of 10 on IMDb, not too bad. 30% on Rotten Tomatoes based on 46 reviews, ouch. 50 on Metacritic based on 22 reviews, yeah. And a 2.7 on Letterboxd, also, yeah. Box office-wise, it made $169.4 million off of a $90 million budget, making it the 21st biggest movie of 1997, which, again, is eh, but clearly not the Mission Impossible size hit that Paramount were looking for. So, as always, actually, before I ask you about your relationships to this movie, a couple of questions I was going to ask you both. So, first of all, were you both aware that The Saint is based on a series of novels that predate the 1960s TV show? Because I was not until I started researching this episode.
No.
So the series of novels date back. They started in 1928. They were the author behind them was the British-Chinese author Leslie Charteris, and it's like some 60 novels. Many of them were written by Charteris, but some of them were just kind of edited by him and were ghostwritten. But was spanning over decades. I literally just thought it was based on the 1960s TV show. Which leads to my second question. Now, Wayne, I'm going to guess, because you are British, you might have seen it. Whereas Craig, I feel like you might not have seen it. Would I be correct in making that assumption?
I know it. I know the Volvo, I think it's V4, V3, that he drives in that film. And I know there's Roger Moore, but apart from that, and I know it's an espionage type of The Man from Uncle, Mission Impossible, of that era, of that ilk. You know, Cold War spy thrillery type show. I know that much of it.
I never saw the show. I guess I knew about it in the sense of I heard the name when it was talked about, like with Mission Impossible, with Man from Uncle, all those ones that kind of got lumped in, but only by name. Like that was all I knew about it over here.
Yeah. This is I didn't watch a lot of it, but I definitely watched some repeats of it when I was a kid. And this, and reading into the, you know, doing the research is quite, because I only had a very vague memory of the show, but it's quite different. The film's quite different from the show, in that
I would hope so.
he's more of a, so like basically people come to him when law enforcement can't help them. So he's like a criminal, but he's like a good criminal. Like he'll like. He's kind of like a kind of almost like a Robin Hood type figure of like he sorts wrongs and stuff like that. And, you know, like he'll get info, you know, like on a corrupt politician or something and expose something like that or, you know, things like that. So he's not, unlike in this, he's not just a thief.
Okay, so it's, I guess, the American equivalent would for us would be like the Equalizer, I'd want to say, or things that, or I guess, I mean, the A-Team did that, but it was just such a
kind of
bombastic, like,
yeah,
extreme.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, so it's weird because, like, I also, from what I've read, the show kind of changes where at first he's kind of almost like more like a detective, like a kind of Sherlock Holmesy. You know, like okay. But then he becomes more Bondy as the series goes on. Okay. So it goes from being like a kind of mystery series to kind of more of a kind of fantasy espionage series. So I think the character kind of changes. Also, the character is much more of an action man and much more of a fighter than he is in this film. Which, I mean, he's kind of a .
Oh dear. you can't be nowhere from what he is in yeah. Well let's get into that as we go.
Because we'll talk about that soon enough.
Yeah. I had a moment when I come looking for The Saint, trying to find it on a streaming service, mm-hmm. and put it into Netflix and was like, The Saint. It brings up The Saint. I was like, oh great, I haven't got to go looking for this, it's on Netflix. So I clicked on it. I was like, it doesn't look like The Saint, I know. And there's a film from 2017, which is The Saint.
Yeah, there is a film for it. Yeah. Like, yeah, they're always... I mean, it's more of a franchise than you think. Because there was the show in the 60s. There were all these novels that we didn't know about up until this stage. And there was also a show in the 70s with Ian Ogilvy called The Return of the Saint. And they kept trying to make this... They were trying to make this film for years. Like, apparently there was...
Stop trying to make The Saint happen, for God's sake.
Well, apparently, they were trying to make a film in the late 80s that would have starred Pierce Brosnan coming off of Remington Steele. But that fell through. And then there was one that was going to be made in the early... The Paramount was trying to make in the early 90s that was going to be directed by Sidney Pollack, which had Ralph Fiennes attached to it. And it was like... it's interesting, the journey to the screen of this movie.
But and now there's been, the guy from, I never watched the show, but I know it's big right now, Bridgerton or whatever. He's potentially up for whatever the main actor that's kind of come off that they're talking about him being in the reboot or a remake sequel. I don't know, whatever they're going to do of the same.
Stop it. Just leave it alone. Good Lord. It's all Tom Cruise's fault with those bloody Mission Impossible, you know, billion-dollar films. Let's just keep rebooting it, isn't it? Yeah.
That's the other thing. That's the other thing that I didn't mention, as well as the TV shows and the books and you know all that in this film and the 2017 film. There is about 8 Saint films from the late 30s into the 40s, you know, predating the TV show, obviously. Between like 1938 and 1943 or something, I think I read.
What?
Yeah, no.
The Saint is older than... He's older than James Bond.
Yeah, predates Bond. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I wasn't expecting to come on here and get, you know, every day is a school day and all that, I suppose. Oh, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, no, I mean, there's all sorts of things that I was not aware of. I just thought there was like the sixth. I'm vaguely aware of the 70s TV show as well, but I just thought there was the 2 TV shows, there was this movie, and then there was the 2017 movie, and that's it. But no, there's all these films, and there's these books, and all sorts of... some of the films, the 30s and 40s films starred George Sanders, who is possibly most famous for doing the voice of Shere Khan in The Jungle Book. A whole cornucopia of things that I did not know about The Saint going into this episode.
I mean, I'll forget all this tomorrow, but now it's like, wow. Oh, that's ridiculous.
There you go. Anyway, I didn't actually ask the regular question of what is your relationship to this movie, so I'll go with you first, Wayne.
Right, I saw this at the pictures at the cinema in 97. I was a regular to the cinema all the time, and there was something about this. I think it was off the back of maybe Tombstone and Ghost in the Darkness, which was a fantastic film. I love Ghost in the Darkness, even though Val Kilmer's accent work in that is nearly as good as it is in The Saint. And I remember going to the pictures, and I remember 2 things that happened in this film. That's it. Yep. I remember the god-awful disguises, and I remember Elizabeth Shue getting naked to warm Val Kilmer up. And I couldn't tell you the context of either. That's how much this film weighed on me. That's all I can remember of the cinema going experience. I know that I saw the film, and I remember those 2 moments, and that's it. I couldn't tell you the plot. I couldn't tell you what it was about, whether it was a heist film or what. That's it. It's been, 23 years, 24 years since I saw it. So
okay.
So yeah. Oh, and then having to try and find it to watch for the podcast was an absolute monumental uphill struggle because I couldn't find it anywhere. And then out of the blue, it turned up in my local CEX, and in good true form for my good self, it cost me £1.
Oh, well done. So this is a true crossover. Oh, and Craig, what about you?
So I remember watching it. I mean, all I remember from watching it when I was a child, because I know my parents must have rented it on VHS, was the, surprisingly, the opening scene where he's the little kid and he's holding onto the bars and he wants the kiss, and then the girl is killed. That's all I remembered. Then in high school, I had an English teacher who knew I was interested in things like in film and screenwriting and even comic books and stuff like that. And I think trying to work with me more, he ended up, like, he suggested all this stuff, and he suggested David Mamet at one point. I know, Scott, I've told you the story where he told me that, oh, well, David Mamet wrote a movie that's really interesting where it's about Val Kilmer saving the president's daughter, but it's never revealed, and that's Spartan. And what he ended up telling me is that he also did, he told me The Saint as well, wrote that. I went, oh, okay. So I watched both of them. Obviously, David Mamet didn't write The Saint.
Nope. Not learned, connected to it in any way.
Yeah, so I believed that for all these years. And they're vastly different in terms of their writing. But then I still remembered is just that opening scene. And I never knew what it was attached to. And then a year ago, there was a deal on Vudu, which is like for digital movies and stuff like that.
Mm.
And it was $7.99 for like three movies, digital movies. I was like, oh, I'll do it. I picked the two I wanted and I couldn't really think of anything else. So it's like, oh, well, there's the Saint. I guess I need to have three of them. So I put it on there. So I've owned it for a year now digitally, but this is the first time I've watched it. And probably about what? Over 15 years or so. And there was stuff I remember I was watching it, but up until that point, I didn't remember anything at all.
Yeah, I really didn't remember much about this film. I know I have definitely seen it from beginning to end once. I didn't see it in the cinema. I maybe saw it. I either rented it or I saw it on telly. And I know that I have seen bits of it on telly a couple of times since then. Definitely when I was watching it, I was like, oh, I remember kind of more of this movie than I thought I did. Because I was just like, I struggled to really remember much at all. There were certain moments where I was like, oh, this kind of feels familiar. I don't know, for some reason, obviously we'll get to it when it happens, but for some reason the kind of date they have in the restaurant, or like the weird where he like walks up to her, like that, I was like, oh, that seems kind of oddly familiar. Interesting. There is like way stranger stuff that happens in this film that I didn't remember for some reason, that I'm like watching it, I'm like, why didn't I remember this? Why didn't I remember this weird rat club? I don't know, the fuck is this? That's a design choice that we will talk about more later. So that's me as well. So like we basically all had seen it once, and then have not seen it in my case probably 20 years. In your case, Craig, 15, and in your case, Wayne, like the full 23, 24.
Since it debuted at the cinema, I think I was there the second week it was on.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, amazingly, this film never gets shown on television either. It's not one of those ones that's constantly, in ITV2's playlist of films. It's never on, amazingly, you know.
Yeah. It's weird that, though. Like, it's kind of, because it feels like it kind of could be like a kind of ITV2 or even like a kind of five-star type.
Oh,
I don't mean like...
It's got five-star written all over it, is that?
Yeah, But like for Craig, five-star is a channel. I'm not talking about the quality of the movie. Yeah. It's a TV channel.
Okay, that makes sense. No, but in this movie, I didn't realize, I guess going into it and thinking of things like Mission Impossible, all of that, are thinking heist movies, and going into it, there's so much that it's just more of like so much that's just a romance that I wasn't expecting, that I was like, oh, okay, so we're just doing all this now. We're not even worried about the heist. He's not even that good at this heist stuff. He's just...
Yeah. That's true. There was a lot of studio interference in this movie.
Surely not.
So there was two separate reshoots that happened, because apparently some of the test audiences liked the romance. So it was recut, because basically in the original cut, Elizabeth Shue's character, Emma Russell, dies three quarters of the way through the movie. She is killed, and then there is this big fiery climax that happens at the end of the movie, where he has this battle with the villain on top of a chandelier. Basically, if you look up the Saint alternate ending on YouTube, you can see what kind of what the original ending was going to be with this battle that he has with the villain of the movie's son, Ilya.
Okay.
Chief Henchman number one, that's what I'll call him.
Yes. So yeah, he has this basically there is a point later on in the movie where we discover that the kind of mansion headquarters of Ivan has like a kind of pool of oil underneath it, and there is a tank fires on the place, and then explodes the oil underneath the building, and then they're kind of fighting on top of the chandelier, and then Simon cuts the chandelier, and he, you know, falls in the big fiery, you know, and you can actually watch that clip on YouTube if you type in the same alternate ending, and it's from an old Russian VHS, it says in the description. Because it's not in English, it's in Russian. It's, you can't listen to the dialogue or whatever.
Was it found in the same Transylvania mine as Event Horizon?
It could be, but no, it was Russian. It was Russian because it's actual. We can't just, unlike this movie, we can't just say people are Russian when they're, you know.
Why not? Russian. Why not?
Which is, that's another thing about this movie, that there's, so I get that, you know, there's so many movies obviously where they're in a different country that doesn't primarily speak English, and they are, that's common, whatever, especially if it's made by an American or English studio, but this one there's specifically speaking Russian at parts, but then at so many other moments you're like, wait, why is everybody else just, why aren't they speaking Russian then? You just have all the
we got to get to that later on, because
we're gonna get in. So like we've been talking maybe kind of 15-20 minutes, so like we now should probably get into the plot of the movie. And for the listeners, if this is the first time you've listened to one of our episodes, we talk about the plot of the movie from beginning to end, so we spoil everything. So if you've not seen the movie, you want to see the movie, go away, see the movie. Anyway, this is your official spoiler alert. But now to Craig to start the movie.
So to start the movie, we are told that it is in the Far East yesterday, which does not necessarily mean yesterday as in yesterday, but in the past. And we are up at this, basically an orphanage run by the church. And this kid that we come to learn is Val Kilmer, is Simon Templar. He's causing a ruckus, and the priest hates it. And because he is reading something else instead of the Bible, and while the priest keeps telling him, you need to say your name, because each one of you was named after a saint, all of you, you know, basically bastard born, and so on and so forth.
We should probably explain that the name the church gave him was John Roti, and like Simon Templar is the name he picks himself, and it's like,
so he's forced to either declare his name in front of God, but he takes that time instead to make this basically a lockpick, because if he because until he says his name, none of the boys would get to eat their food. So he makes the lockpick, undoes the food, and all the boys eat the food, and they're cheering for him, and he's kind of seen as the Simon the magician, and they're running through this whole area because they're going to escape, and and the girl Agnes that he, you know, has a crush on, she comes out to him, and he just wants a kiss before, you know, he leaves. A nun finds out the girls are missing. They apparently need police dogs to hunt down small children, and Agnes is pounced on by a German, like a large German shepherd, and plummets to her death, which then Simon is horrified, and that shows him merge into, you know, Val Kilmer age.
It's all a bit trite, isn't it, the start?
Yeah.
It's all a bit like, okay. And to be fair, this is 1997, and a lot about the Catholic Church hasn't come out at this point. Yeah. So you watch it in 1997 and go, this all seems a bit much. You got dogs on children, and this This priest is an absolute maniacal tyrant. What the hell's going on? And then you find out what happened in the recent, you know, in the last 10 years, what's been going on in the Catholic Church for a very long time in orphanages. And you go, actually, you've underplayed it just a little bit.
Yeah. Well, we don't want to go too deep down that rabbit hole.
No.
But yeah, again, this is one of the differentiations from like the show and the books and all that kind of stuff like that. Because I think he's like an enigmatic figure and we don't really know much about him. Whereas, so this tragic backstory has just been tacked on for the movie.
Yeah. And that is, again, will be explained upon by all of us later on, but for somebody who's supposed to be kind of this mysterious figure that nobody knows him, and he gives himself up, he tells people a lot, or you know, he gives a lot away. But yeah, I definitely watching that, it was like, wait, so he's just like, these two dogs are just pulling this priest down the hallway, and when they pounce on the girl, what kind of, why would you have dogs like that trying to find children? Like, the dog doesn't even just try and grab her or sniff or like, oh, it barks and acknowledges. It's like full on as if it was a criminal attack.
Yeah, it just like pounces on her. And yeah, and then she just falls off the stairwell and to her death, which is apparently scarred Simon for life. Because like this is kind of portrayed that this is like a recurring nightmare that Simon... Yes.
A recurring nightmare that is never mentioned again in the film.
Well, it is in flashback late on.
When he has hypothermia, he mentions it kind of.
Yes, and then there is a flashback to that scene just after that, but it doesn't really play into the movie much. But there's a lot of things to unpack here, so we should move on to what's happening in the present day. Where we have,
or tomorrow, as they call it.
Tomorrow, yes. Where we have Val Kilmer as Simon Templar listening to his mission breakdown. I don't know. I feel like that's kind of like an actor getting into a part. I suppose that's how it's maybe being portrayed. Because I was just thinking, like, this feels like unnecessary. Like he's listening to himself recount, like what he has to do, and I'm like, it's okay. So maybe. I was trying to make sense of why this is happening. And I was like, oh, well, maybe it's like an actor trying to get into the part. So he's like listening to himself while he's putting the stuff on. It still doesn't really. Yeah. I'll go with that.
And he looks at himself the whole time. And it happens several times throughout this movie where he'll look at himself in the mirror and, you know, he'll say a couple lines and then he'll kind of turn his head and look back again and give like a, Val Kilmer smoldering look or something, and then he'll do it again.
The smug looks he gives in this film are one of the joys of the movie. Like, it's one of the best things.
Yeah, but this one is apparently an Australian with short gray hair, a gray mustache in Moscow. So that's who he decided to.
When he's in the mirror, he's doing a Russian accent. So originally a Russian character. When he first goes undercover to break into this building, he is a Russian who then becomes an Australian when he is caught out by Ivan's son, Ilya, who we just think is, I don't know, like just like a coke-addled idiot at this, you know, when we're first introduced to him, but apparently is a badass who is totally equal and actually looks like he could have beat up Simon, you know, when he captures, well, when he finds out that he's like stealing shit.
Yeah, and what's interesting is that the son. A lot of people make a lot of assumptions in this movie that is just because the script says so. So Simon, he sneaks in, he goes up some stairs, then he climbs up the window to another port, and then goes up some more stairs to get this microchip. And what you end up during this whole, it's basically a big speech that is being given.
Yeah, it's very Roman Empire, isn't that? You know, friends, Russians, countrymen, you know, all that.
And this is by, you know, who is like the main villain of the movie, Ivan Tretiak, who is played by I'm going to try and get this. I've listened to pronunciation of this in a few interviews before coming on to this. So the actor who plays Ivan Tretiak is Rade Šerbedžija. I'm terribly sorry to any Croatian listeners who are offended by that pronunciation, because yes, he's playing a Russian, but he's Croatian. So yes, but that's my best attempt in it, and hopefully I've got it close to what it actually is, because he's a good actor. Yeah, and he's great, you know, and I particularly like him as Boris the Blade in Snatch. He's really good in that.
Has Rade Šerbedžija and Peter Stormare ever played their own nationality? That's the question.
Has he ever played Croatian? I don't think so. No, I think he's mainly played Taken, Russians.
Yeah, in Taken he plays either Ukrainian or Russian. Mm. In Eyes Wide Shut he definitely plays a Russian who's trying to pimp his daughter out, I seem to remember.
No, he's mainly played Russians in his career. Yeah. I've never seen him play a Croatian.
But yeah, this is the first scene you get where it's a Russian speech. People are randomly saying Russian lines to each other, but then his speech is completely in English, and most of all that happens is completely in English, which then kind of makes this weird dynamic setup. But yeah, the son, he goes out to snort some cocaine, apparently out of his watch, and he sees an open window, and then instantly, this is kind of that assumption, he's like, oh, somebody must have broken and went all the way up to the safe area. And
that's true. Although, I do want to point out that his son, Ilya Tretiak, is played by Valery Nikolaev, who is actually Russian.
Hey! Finally. We're only 20 minutes into the film, we've finally seen a Russian. Great!
But one of his cohorts, the son's right-hand man, is played by Scottish actor Tommy Flanagan.
Yeah. I saw that and went, hang on, that guy's not fucking Russian. just before we move on, do we think that the makers of The Saint have got a very big cause to sue Marvel and Sony Pictures for Spider-Man Far From Home for the outfit that The Saint wears at the start of this and the covert Spider-Man outfit? Or was it just me sitting there going, you're in trouble here, lads?
I can see your point. I think they have a case. I think Paramount might have a case. Paramount, if you are listening.
Slip us a tenner, we come up with it first.
Well, I mean, like, we did an episode on the movie Breakdown, and I interviewed the director of that movie, Jonathan Mostow, and that's Paramount Pictures. So I think we've got the in with Paramount now.
Yeah.
Get him in there. So you'll find out tomorrow that Disney's now acquired Paramount Pictures just to smooth this little bump in the road over.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Let's get back to the movie. Yes. We've covered nothing.
Not unlike the film, to be fair.
So the son, makes the assumption, goes up. He finds that the laser grid hasn't even been deactivated. He deactivates it. So he still assumes somebody's broken in, apparently. Goes through all these corridors and then ends up at the vault where Simon has just retrieved the microchip he was looking for. And this is where he pulls the gun on him, and Simon tries to barter, saying, I'm being offered in his Australian accent now.
Yes.
I'm being offered $1 million. I'll split that with you 50-50, that for your drug habit or something like that. And this son is actually, he will not. As much as Simon brings up your father isn't good to you or your father is lying to you or anything like that, the son actually stays pretty loyal to the father throughout the movie.
But, as you would.
Yeah.
You know, as your dad.
Yeah.
That's true. Not in the original cut. In the original cut, Ilya becomes the main villain because he just shoots his dad.
I could see that happening, yeah. Absolutely.
Also, I really like the exchange, like when he pulls out the gun For some reason, it really made me laugh when in his Aussie accent, he was just like, "Oh, Mike, don't worry about it. Just guns make me nervous." And then Ilya says, "Ooh, suck me sideways." And yeah. I'm like, what? What is that? What kind of insult is that? We were all
saying that in 97. Every single one of us was saying that in 1997.
Was that like the most popular insult of 1997? I just wasn't aware.
Where I'm from, yeah. I'm from Dudley in the West Midlands. Yeah. Yeah, every single one of us at 17 years old was saying that. It was the main insult it was.
Okay. I was obviously too young. I was only 12 at the time. So. Yeah.
But he also makes that comment too about what he doesn't like. How's he phrase it? He doesn't like condoms, so take them. Basically telling him to take his mask off. Or he doesn't like protection.
Yeah,
or something.
That's how it's a weird way he puts that. Yes.
Yeah.
I absolutely loving this scene where they get to talking, they get to having these little exchanges. He drops the microchip stroke. It would be an SD card now. He drops the microchip, and you know it's going to go all sideways. And then you think, okay, in the vein of these films, you know, of the time, it's going to be a nice little, you know, what's going to happen in the first exchange between them. And the Saint nearly enough gets battered, and I loved every minute of it. It's like complete. No, you're a nothing. I'm gonna hand your ass to you, and I'm gonna do it smiling. It's fantastic. Loved every moment, every punch and kick that he lands is brilliant.
It's a weird scene though, because in terms of the setup of the movie that we've had so far, which is again very little, but he's been set up as like this super sleuth. This kind of, master thief, you know, like he's in all the professional gear. He's got all this stuff, and we see him sneaking about. And so we, from that very little snippet, we get a sense that this guy is professional. He is a badass. And from the very little snippet of the son we get before this, it's just like, oh, he's the waster son of like a billionaire guy who's got a coke problem. And then all of a sudden they fight, and it's like, oh, this kid is like kicking his ass. Like, this loser is kicking his ass. Like, what if he met like a real badass? Like, he'd be in real trouble. Like, the hero of our movie? Like, really?
we need to move on to the moment how he escapes Ilya, which is by far the most incredulous scene. Bearing in mind, we're talking about Cold Fusion taking over as the world's leading energy supplier. Yeah. In this film, this is the most incredulous moment of the film for me.
Go for it, Wayne.
So Ilya's got the Saint in a headlock, and through some trite, strange explanation, I may have been writing a note, there's a fire explosion, some sort of flamethrower, that Ilya and the Saint are stood about 50, 60, 70 feet away from, but somehow it scorches Ilya's eyes, so he has to let go of the Saint. At which point I paused the DVD because I was like, I've missed something here, haven't I?
He throws like a flash bomb onto the safe, but for some reason, yes, it only affects Ilya. So it doesn't really be, like, you do see the Saint like palm like a kind of flash bomb onto the safe, but it still doesn't make sense. It only affects Ilya.
It's the distance. It's how far and how it affects him. It's like, oh my God, I can't see. I'm going to have to let everything go. Oh! And then he's fine in the next scene. It's crazy. But that's how this film sets up.
That is how this film sets up. And it sets it up nicely because Simon disappears out a window, and we get our first sting of the Saint theme music. So that's fun.
Yeah, I do love this.
But
who was it who recreated the Saint theme for this film? Was it Orbital?
Orbital.
Yeah, I absolutely love that. And it's completely underused in the film. They should really be bashing that about because it's a banging soundtrack.
Because, yeah, he jumps off the building onto a padded truck, basically, changes disguises. Somebody sees him, but is like, oh, it's just some bum now or whatever, and then pushes him to the side. But then they go looking for but he goes next to another homeless man, gives him a bottle of vodka. And then when they find who they think it is going to be the saint, then it's just the other homeless man. And then while the saint is now wearing, I mean, Simon is now wearing long hair and with like headphones and he's taking pictures. So he's already in a different disguise.
I did, for all his fault, I did enjoy that. I thought it was a nice little Harry escape sort of thing, you know. He's put his arms around that bloke with a bottle of vodka. I thought that was at least credible.
that's very funny. And then, interestingly, we see him on a plane, and he's now in a different disguise as his, I called him Spanish Jim Morrison on a plane. Because that's kind of what he is. And it's interesting as well, because much like in The Ghost in the Darkness, where Emily Mortimer has a small role in which she's completely wasted, Emily Mortimer turns up in a small role where she's completely wasted.
I think I closed my eyes for this moment, so I didn't see her.
If you blink, she says something about that cross he's holding, and then says it's his grunt, or it was, you know, I'm not even going to try. I already botched a German accent. He says it's his grandmother's, you know, and then she's being moved to England by her husband while everything is going sour in Russia.
I should mention that as much as I think Emily Mortimer is a great actress, her Russian accent is as whoopee as Val Kilmer's accents. She is doing the full kind of, yes, I am Russian woman.
Let's give some praise to Emily Mortimer, because would you bother trying to put on a Russian accent if all they're paying you is a tube of Pringles?
That's a fair point. You make a fair point, Wayne. But I believe in your defense of Emily Mortimer. She is absolved of all sins of acts.
And we must say, in Ghosts in the Dark and the Darkness, we praise that she deserved way more than she got in that. So we are Emily Mortimer fans. So he seduces her. No, first they go through customs, and of course Scotland Yard is there, and they're like, oh, well, he kind of looks like the guy, but I guess he's not, because even though he has the same eyes, the same chin, the same facial structure, but he has long black hair now, and he doesn't sound like an Australian, so I guess it's not him. Well, let's just let him go through.
Again, and it's these things of like the plot says so, because it's like, well, the police have reasonable suspicion there. Yeah. You know, it looks kind of like the same game. Like, you know, they probably would pick it. But Inspector Teal, played by Johnny actor Alan Armstrong, he is like, no, I suppose we can't lift him.
Yeah, because
yet they know that he wears disguises too. They have all of the different disguises.
That is true.
Like, yeah.
Brilliant.
I feel like Inspector Rabineau, who played by Charlotte Cornwell, should really be leading the investigation, because she is very much like, yeah, but he looks the same. Like, he looks like he's the same. Should we not lift him? And Inspector Teal's like, no, I just...
It's probably 10 minutes to lunch, wasn't it? It's all that paperwork. Fuck this shit. Let him go. Whatever. We'll catch him somewhere else.
It's like the one with Superman or something. The one person that's like, hey, that looks a lot like Superman, but he's wearing glasses. Maybe it's him. And everybody's like, no, it can't be.
Are you mad?
This movie.
That's right, yeah.
I've got to point out at this moment, we are 20 minutes into it, and we have not reached the main plot of this film at all.
That is true.
All this exposition.
We'll speed along.
Not us. We're doing fine. I'm on about the actual film. 20 minutes into this film, and we're nowhere near the main plot.
Yeah. Well, we're not into the main plot, and we've been recording for about 45 minutes. So, like...
Yeah, so what basically ends up happening is that they don't find the microchip on him during scans or anything, because he put it in the cross which he gave to Emily Mortimer, which then he apparently seduces at a later date, even though she talks about being married and all that, and retakes the microchip when she's sleeping, leaving her a rose. And yeah, then it's him in his, I guess, other new hideout or wherever he goes, different hotel rooms, and he's getting an encrypted message that reads like something completely different. It's like a whole letter, but when you press a button, it like shifts the words and letters to give a different message saying that somebody wants him for another mission. And he's trying to reach $50 million so then he could just retire.
Because $42 million's not enough to retire.
Yeah, I was just thinking exactly that. $42 million in 1997, that buys a lot of donuts, that does.
But anyway, he's looking for that nice round number of $50 million. So he's got to take on one last job. So this is... It's a real mixture of various types of movies. none of which kind of add up, but anyway, we got to get on with the actual main plot of the movie, because we're now into the main plot of the movie, as he has to go to the scientist's lecture because he is trying to steal the formula for cold fusion, which is the energy of the future, and the Emma Russell, the scientist, is played by Elizabeth Shue, and he goes along as a journalist, pretending to be a kind of old crotchety English journalist with wonky teeth. And but the thing that entertains me about this scene, right? So he goes and he talks to Emma, and he knows who Emma is, right? And he basically says, like, you don't believe in this cold fusion mumbo jumbo. And then Emma's like, oh, yeah, I do, because obviously she's going to be the one talking. And then after she goes up to talk to the class, he says, oops, as if he's made a faux pas. Now, why would he do that? Because it's like he knows he's just saying that as part of the act because, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah. No, yeah, I didn't understand that part because I thought, well, did he only know her by name or did he actually know her face? I don't know. It didn't make sense. There's other parts when he's in character, he says certain things that you're like, so is that his real self coming through? And I don't, especially when it comes, it's specifically with anything that deals with Emma, that himself is coming through, which I guess they're trying to show, but doesn't work fully. But we did forget to mention, though, before that happens, he does meet with the Russians again as the German
Our friend Bruno, of course.
Yes, his German agent or whatever it's supposed to be, like his handler that he plays. But it's really not important to the, it's just he meets with the same people he just stole from and they know it's him the whole time, but he's still playing the character.
they're completely impressed with how he rumbled them in Moscow. So now they want him to do a job for them, and the minute he walks away, Ivan says to Ilya, it doesn't matter, we'll kill him in the end anyway. And it's like, he's very nonchalant and nothing, and it's like you say, it's a point in the film that probably could have been handled in an email.
Absolutely.
47, yeah, we got sorted. Well, they could have done it on that Lotus messaging board where he does all those cryptic messages. You could have done it there.
Yeah.
It's one of those.
Absolutely. The funny thing about that scene is, as well, he's supposed to be this master of disguise, but Ilya, who's maybe the smartest person in this movie, immediately sees through the disguise. He doesn't have any doubt. He's just like, oh, no, that's the exact same guy I saw. He's just like wearing a wig and shit.
Yeah.
Oh dear. Yeah, he goes and breaks into Elizabeth's. Well, he breaks into Emma Russell's apartment after seeing her at the theoretical Oxford talk about cold fusion, and it's one
where
of the
she
impresses
in
the film.
Class by being like, "Oh yeah, I just have a gut feeling about this," and all these scientists go, "Yeah, that seems right. Yeah, okay, cool.
Yeah, good feeling. Let's go with that. Wow, that's incredible." But anyway, he breaks into her apartment.
But he realizes,
science, bitch.
He realizes she's not. He's like, oh, she's not evil or anything. She's a little eccentric, but she's innocent or something like. So he's starting to feel a certain way as he just chills too. He's not even a good thief in that sense. He like messes stuff around. He like sits on her couch and just reads.
This is the one I'm talking about. So he breaks into her apartment, and he's doing his own narration of the. of walking around her apartment. Oh, you'd like to have a coffee in the morning, and you do this, and oh yeah, I'm going to lie on your bed. And it's like, what the fuck? Why are we doing this open narration? We're not stupid. We can see what he's doing. Is it? Are you doing this for the hearing, for the people of partial sight? I don't understand why the director thought this was a good idea to have him openly vocal about, you know, talking about what he's doing and trying to explain what she's doing in that apartment after he's broken. It was just really, it was a weird moment within the film. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. It's a very strange choice, but I don't know.
There is a fantastic moment when he breaks into an apartment and we see the MVP of 1997, the backs on which all other technological improvements have been made. We see, which it's been long missing from my life, we see a fantastic floppy disk. Let's hear it for the floppy disk, everybody.
Yeah. Oh, dear. Yeah, absolutely. We should probably...
Yes.
Speed along a bit faster as we get into the main plot.
So she realized. So basically, in a speed round, he realizes she needs a poet in her life. So he dresses up as another Jim Morrison who's supposed to be South African of Boer, and named Thomas Moore. And he then leaves his book. As she's walking through Oxford, she finds him drawing a sculpture. He leaves the book, wink, wink. She finds it and kind of reads through. And then while she's at a pub, I guess. And then he finds her again saying, again, I'm not going to try and do a South African accent because I can't. And neither can Kilmer.
No, you're going to do it now. You're going to have a go now. Yeah.
But he's talking like an artist, the stereotype of what an artist would, and basically seduces her, but he can't be with her, and he's all brooding, and he walks off, he breaks the bottle, and I know Scott wanted to get into this part, and then he's like, what am I doing? I shouldn't be doing this, is a normal voice, and then he is like, okay, keeps going, he cuts his forehead. And then she walks up and is like, oh, what happened? He's like, oh, I was thinking about you, and I smashed my head. And he's like...
Okay, yeah. So yeah. I wanted to talk about a couple of points in this scene. The first point I wanted to talk about was actually in the pub, because I just think it's very, very funny that, like, just to show that she is an eccentric scientist, she keeps all the notes for the equations for the cold formula in her cold fusion formula in her bra, and then the kind of the punchline of the scene is that Simon keeps his money in his crotch. It's just a weird just like she's stuffing notes into her bra, he's pulling money out his crotch. It's just like, what am I watching? Is this like a spoof? Yeah.
That's why I said there's so many points where in that gets so, especially when later on when they're, you know, kissing or whatever, when they keep seeing each other and there's so much sexual tension that it felt so hokey, or it was like those moments of just like chuckling and shaking my head. I had probably a good 40 times, I want to say, in this movie, like, Jesus Christ, what is happening right now?
I mean, let's get into this bit here now. This part of the film.
The other thing, quickly, the other thing, like, because there's two things. The other thing I wanted to quickly mention, and I know you get fed up with this, Craig, because I always bring up professional wrestling in podcasts.
I don't give a fuck.
But right, so, like, in professional wrestling, when a wrestler wants to get color, i.e. bleed, they have, like, in, like, the wrist taping, they will keep, like a thin razor blade, which they can get out of the wrist taping and, like, slice across their forehead and then they kind of hold their breath. And if they do that, you know, it gets the blood running and, like, your face is covered in blood, basically. You know, it's kind of shortcut to get blood. Yeah. And so, like, I think that would have been like an easy way to do it. But like in this movie, like, so he could have just followed the professional wrestling route. But in this film, he takes out a big fucking knife and just stabs it into his head. And I'm like, there's much, I've watched wrestling for many decades now, and it's a much easier way to do this. That maybe you should have talked to a wrestler before you did this.
Yeah.
That's the only point I wanted to make about that specific thing.
There's two things from the pub scene that I want to bring up. Obviously, the first one is Minty shows up from EastEnders. He's there.
That is correct.
I love that scene. And the other thing which blew me away, and it's because it's such a faux pas now, the smoking in the pubs, because it's 1997. And I was like, oh my God, they're actually smoking in the pubs, because it's such a cliched faux pas thing now, isn't it? You don't do that. It's just not done anymore.
Yeah, the smoking ban would not come in for another 9 years.
Yeah, wow. Okay, now I feel old.
Yeah. Because the smoking ban, because I, like, at the time when the smoking ban came in, I was still smoking. So I remember it coming in 2006.
I've got one other point on this moment. Okay. So when, I don't know if you're going to get to this point, but when Elizabeth Shue gets his book and he's looking through and she reads that god-awful poem,
which was written by Val Kilmer himself.
Yep, that's my point. It was written by Val Kilmer, which I found out today, and it only seemed to make the poem worse when I found that out. And this, I mean, they flirt all afternoon in this moment, and the flow of this film just has the handbrake put on right now, and it basically turns into 50 Shades of Saint, doesn't it? It's fucking terrible. I don't know what this section of the film is at all. It needs to be taken out. But there's a moment, and there's a line which stuck in me, I had to write it down. Elizabeth Shue, who I love dearly, and he's probably my first crush on this planet, and I love you forever, Elizabeth Shue, because of your work in Adventures in Babysitting. She says this line with all the charisma she can muster for this 90 million dollars? $90 million turkey. She says, your work is very dangerous and alive. And a part of me died, I'm not going to lie.
I probably should have mentioned that. That was the other big thing in the pub scene. So Simon Templar is supposed to be this enigmatic, ambiguous figure that nobody... unscrutable, you know? Like, that's what he's supposed to be. Yeah. And yet... he reads her because he's read around her apartment, but she reads him in like 2 seconds and he's like, oh shit, she's really seen me. And you're like, what is nobody like, how was it so simple? Like, oh God.
This is one of the movies why Elizabeth Shue quit acting and became a nurse, as we find out in Hamlet 2. <It's on> the-
Yeah.
Oh dear.
Just for listeners who might not be aware, that's a gag from that movie. Elizabeth Shue's still acting and can most recently be seen in The Boys.
So they end up having sex basically while drinking some more, and he doesn't want to take her notes, but that's what I didn't get either, is that he takes her notes and then takes a picture of them anyways, which I thought, you could have just left the notes there, took the picture, and you would have been good. But yeah, he takes the notes, takes the picture, and then faxes them off to the Russians, which then they find out that they don't work, or they're all out of order, and the equations don't really lead up to anything. At face value, it looks like they would, but when kind of actually going through the equations itself, they do not.
I've got to say, the seduction scene that we're talking about right here, this is an action espionage thriller, and the seduction scene that leads up to this moment where he sends these pictures off on the world's greatest digital camera, by the way, it takes 6 minutes. Yep. It's a seduction scene in an action film takes 6 minutes. I was bemused by that, because, like I said, he just puts the handbrakes on the whole film.
Yeah,
and shifts it tonally, completely shifts it from what it was struggling to be an action film at the best of times, but then you move to this, and that, like you say, this is obviously, like you were saying at the start, Scott, with the test audience saying we want more of the romance, so they've gone back and listened, and they've ruined the film, because you've got this 6 minutes of, you know, spoken in the monologue, and oh, will they, won't they, and then she's holding her heart, because she's got heart problems, and oh God. At the end of it, I was like, just fucking move on. Come on, let's let's take the handbrake off. Let's get going.
Yeah. So we attempt to do that as after the scientists express doubt about the Formula 2, a van, basically, Simon and Ivan are like emailing back and forth. Ivan is got somebody emailing for him while he lies on the couch and reads porn. just don't know why. But anyway, that was a choice. Simon is emailing away as well. And then Simon at some point realizes that he's being tricked. He's just being kept online emailing while people track him down, and that's what exactly Ilya and his goons, again one of his goons played by Tommy Flanagan, Glasgow's Tommy Flanagan,
very famous Russian actor Tommy Flanagan.
Well, we've got a track record here, yeah. You know, because obviously, you know, Sean Connery playing the, I think he's Lithuanian in the Hunt for the Red October, is that correct? Yeah. So like, yeah, Scottish people playing Eastern Europeans. That's something we got. That's what I'd be cast as. I'm sure I could do a kind of a Russian accent like this. It's good as anybody else in the film.
Yeah. Scott, where have you gone, mate? We've got Russian interference. Where are you, mate? Have you gone? Flawless, mate. Flawless, that one.
Excellent.
So she finds out that he took everything. She goes to, you know, obviously the two really good police officers and Scott, the detectives in Scotland Yard, are basically like, was this one of the men? She's like, oh, yeah, I guess. Yeah, it looks like it.
Oh no! The shootout happens before she's been interviewed by the police. Okay. So like, Ilya goes to the house. They have this like Simon escapes. Ilya shoots a police officer, which again doesn't make sense because he does this in like the middle of like Oxford or whatever, and he is the son of a Russian like billionaire who's like a media figure, so that would definitely be in the papers, but I suppose we shouldn't scrutinize this too hard.
No. But Simon is able to escape through the car, and then they're about to chase after him with the car and maybe have a great kind of car chase scene, but no, the cops are just there, so they're like, oh well, let's just go this way. that's the end of it. That's, you know, the running theme of the movie. Something really good, cool is about to happen, and then it doesn't.
Yes. So again, we'll speed up again a little bit. You were right. Next thing that happens is Emma being interviewed by the police. It turns out that Emma is smarter than the police because she works out in 2 seconds that all of Simon's aliases are based on saints, and they're like, "Oh shit, yeah."
And
we've been working this case for 2 years. We haven't worked that out, but you are onto something, lady.
She goes, can you get me the records of a flight to all the flights to Moscow so I could see who like on the flight would have a saint's name? And they don't at any point think, oh, we should do that too, because maybe we could get the jump on him. No, they're like, oh, okay, yeah, just take it, whatever.
Outside of their jurisdiction. Yeah, they can't, exactly. They can't be fucking about with that, you know?
Yeah.
2 minutes paperwork.
Yeah.
And then after that, we cut to the rat club that has rat races, literal rat races. I don't know if this is some sort of sly commentary on capitalism that I'm not getting or something, but and people bet on the rat races, and they got like little tubes on the wall, but also it seems to be a restaurant, and also it seems to be a brothel. There's a lot going on,
and there's a really good cameo that will pop up later. Well, not later in the movie, but in this season.
In this scene, yes. There is a cameo from David Schneider, who also cameos as a train engineer in Mission Impossible.
And all he does is he comes through the curtain, he's like, hey, and then that's it.
Yeah, in the In the credits, he's credited as Rat Club Comedian, but it looks like he's about to do a magic trick before we cut away from him, so that's kind of weird.
Oh, dear. Talk about it, isn't it? I like in this scene that they've replaced all the plates that would have been of cocaine, because this film is a 12, and replaced it with plates of money, because, you know, it's the same thing.
And so he ends up getting held up by Simon, because Simon is dressed as Ivan. And he says, "You're going to put the money in my account, or, you know, basically going to kill you." Ivan makes the phone call, puts the money in his account, and then Simon scurries off saying, "Oh, there's an imposter." And so Ivan's own men think that he's the imposter, as Simon's kind of able to slip out and do his thing.
Yep. Which is, I mean, he doesn't look that like Ivan, you know, like, but anyway, yes, it was very.
I think he looks like, I think he looks like 2015 Jim Carrey, if I'm honest.
Yeah, that's a good shout. Oh, dear. And again, Simon Templar, master thief, super sleuth, all-round badass, found in roughly 2 seconds by Emma Russell, eccentric scientist, in Moscow.
Because there were two people named after saints, and one of them was a small woman or something. And then, so obviously it had to be him. So that was it. And because he looks exactly like all the other parts. That too.
Oh dear. But so Emma looks really smart for about 2 seconds until she's like, "Now you can arrest him." And she immediately gets arrested as well, because Russia in this film is totally corrupt. And run apparently by a man. He runs the deep state.
The thing about her is she's not. So he steals her codes, all this stuff, and then she's still not even. They don't set up that dynamic that she's mad at him, and then they have to work together, and there's the tension, or any of that stuff that could then maybe make the romance, or maybe make anything with the movie more, you know, the. Exciting, I guess, in that sense. It's like she's just basically, "Oh, I would have given you the codes if you asked, or I would have given you the equations," and still just like smitten with him. Even when he sees her, he's kind of happy, not like, "Oh, I'm sorry for what I did." It's like,
he looks permanently smug and unperturbed by everything that happens, even when he's regularly beaten up or captured. It's one of his fun quirks.
So they get captured, and then they're put in the back of a police van. But unfortunately, so they're not watched. It's just assumed they're probably going to stay in there. And she starts having heart issues, and he was able to snag some of her pills. So she takes the pills by him turning and kind of putting his hand out and her eating them out of his hand. And then she is able to get his knife, but... Again, in the theme with this movie, we are unable to see the actual escape. It's just by the time they get there, they're gone, or they're out of the truck.
I mean, I don't know about you. I didn't need to see the escape. Yeah, there's that moment of innuendo in the back of the van. I was just like, "Whoa, I'm burning up here with all that sexual chemistry. My God."
That's basically how this movie then shifts. It's like, oh, they just take out all of the potential heist stuff or anything, and they're like, "Let's just kind of make this erotic thriller."
Yeah, that's true. So we should maybe mention what happens. Basically, after she eats the heart tablets or the palm of his hand, she is on her knees, and then like Val Kilmer raises his eyebrow and is like, "Oh, since you're down there," and then it's like, "Oh, actually, get the knife out my boot," and you're like, "Ah, I see what you did there, movie."
Yeah.
Oh, classic. I wonder who wrote that classic line, whether it was Wesley Strick or Jonathan Hensley.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. Anyway, moving on. Craig, what happens next?
They find out that they're not there. They're like, oh, go looking for them. And then, again, all of this is in English, even though it's just all Russian people speaking to each other. And so it goes into one of those classic spy elements where they're running down the street, the cops or somebody is coming, and they think, well, let's just act like we're a couple kissing, even though the cops, that wouldn't technically claim innocence like in other movies, like in, you know, either Mission Impossible or whatever, many other films where they're like, oh, let's not mind these two kissing people. It's like, oh, they are a couple. There's a man and a woman who are in the general vicinity kissing. That's probably them then, because that would make logical sense. But no,
if you are on the run with a woman and you do drag her into an alley and start making out with her, you become invisible. That is what movie says to me.
And so they do that, but it's instead of the fake, like the where they're just kind of fake necking or whatever it may be, they're kissing, and then they just for a long, it feels like a good couple minutes, they're then just kind of talking and kissing.
It does, because there's various kind of like platoons of like police people like going back and forth, so there's like several units go by of like there's like one unit goes by and they're kissing, and then it's like, oh, like looks like it's safe, oh no, and it's like, oh no, there's another unit, one more kissing, and it's like, oh, okay, this is dragged out longer than this bit is usually in spy movies.
And it feels like at some point there's not even any cops anymore. He's just probably keeps doing it. Oh, there's some cops coming. Let's just go.
Yeah, I definitely saw some Russian gangsters out the side of my eye. Let's keep doing this.
I think that scene's really out of place, because if they were in Paris, you could go, okay, there's a couple kids and it's the city. Love, and it's Paris, and it's all there in London. You can, but the way this film has set up Moscow to be this totalitarian, you wouldn't be kissing on a street. You know, native Russian people would not be kissing under the arches of a bridge, knowing full well there's platoons running by. So it sort of doesn't. I'm digging real deep on this, I know, but it doesn't fit with that whole, you know, ethos that they've built around Moscow.
Yeah.
So they'd be shot. They wouldn't even be captured.
That's probably
what the thing that we haven't really mentioned. Like, so this movie, again, of the many movies that this movie wants to be, one of them is like a political thriller where we're kind of investigating where Russia was at in the 90s in its transition from communism to capitalism, and how the kind of oligarchs rose, and like it's presented in this way that basically there is it's on the brink of basically a second Russian revolution in this movie. That's how it's presented, that it's got to such a febrile kind of state that's where we are. So it could boil over at any second, and you're right, you know, you're clear, that couple kissing are clearly not going to be natives to Moscow.
That's a dark, kind of dingy tunnel. Yeah, it doesn't really. Yeah, you're right, Wayne, about that it not fitting. But also,
nice places.
Yeah. So this Moscow too, they don't have for the last what you're assuming couple of years. There's been an oil shortage, and so. They don't really have any heat, and this is in winter in Moscow, and so people are freezing to death, and so there's kind of this huge uproar in that sense as well.
Which we don't really explore. Like, there's a kind of these things that are kind of thrown up of kind of like, because there's kind of beats of the movie where it's like, oh, this could be an almost interesting political thriller, kind of exploring that whole situation. Of like how all of these kind of former communists became like billionaires, like and the rise of, you know, the rise of the oligarchs and that kind of stuff. But it doesn't really explore it to any extent other than just kind of mentioning this is happening.
That's it's a very strange movie in that all senses. Like, I know I'll keep bashing on it, and I know, yeah, all of us will, but while you're watching it, there's so many movies, especially in this podcast, where you can go, okay, it was trying to do this, but it may have failed, or it was trying to do this and this to combine and whatever. Where this one specifically, you're just watching in almost in awe of, like, what is it actually trying to be? What is it trying to do here?
It's kind of trying to be like a One Last Job heist movie. It's kind of trying to be like a James Bond style spy movie. And it's kind of trying to be a kind of more complex political kind of John le Carré spy thriller. And it's also trying to be an erotic thriller.
Yes. And then a lighthearted caper too.
And
some elements too. Yeah.
Yeah. Like a kind of, I don't know, like a North by Northwest.
Yes.
I mean, all like mentioning this film in North by Northwest in the same breath, probably. I'll probably be struck down.
I was thinking North by Northwest was not one of them.
To catch a thief,
But I do like these plots that we just gave up on, I feel like, in cinema anymore, because if you mention anything about saving the world or climate change or anything in that sense, you're going to have different parties battling it out. But there was like this period where it's like, oh, the big solution here is that there's a device that can potentially get rid of all oil and cold fusion. You would never need to worry about, you know, you could save the environment. You could not have to worry about fossil fuels, all this stuff. And there were so many movies that kind of had those plots. And then we just, I think as a society, we're like, okay, we're not going to talk about that anymore. Let's just.
Well, yeah, because like, I don't remember, like, you know, I was very young at the time, but I don't remember this film being like controversial in any way.
No.
In the same way that some environmentally themed action movies a la Mad Max Fury Road, you know, like seem to annoy people, you know.
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, it's, I suppose like Twitter hadn't been invented, so that's probably a big factor there. Yeah. Anyway, moving on with the story. Wayne, can you pick up the plot?
Yeah, so after this rendezvous under the arches and kissing for no apparent reason in front of soldiers, they move... where she realizes, where Emma realizes that the saint is a no good capitalist who wants to sell her cold fusion for millions of dollars. And as she runs off through the train station, they realize they're being hunted by Ilya's men. Is it Ilya? Oh, God, I've lost his name.
Ilya, yeah.
Ivan's men. Yeah, they're being hunted by Ilya.
The two goons that are kind of following them seem to be attached to Ilya. I mean, I suppose they're all Ivan's men, but like, yeah.
Yeah. So they escape. This is one of the scenes of the film. I actually remember this. They escape to the river in Moscow. And this is one of those moments in a film where if you just stand still, you're not going to get caught. But it's a cat and mouse thing where the saint and Emma are running across the like icy edge of the river. And Ilya and his men are checking doors on the riverbank and running across like the edge. And at some point, Emma drops her heart pills and the saint ever so chivalrously leans over the water to get them and falls in and has to dive under the water so he's not seen by Ilya. Of course, then Ilya just gives up on the idea that he's got a hunch that something's going on down there, and they get in the car and drive away. The saint comes out the water totally soaked and freezing, and they head off towards some sort of Maisonette's flats or flats, some settlement with some Russians.
Yep.
And we get one of the most 1997 moments of the film of a 12, but not being really much outright. So this Russian, this block of flats. And once again, as Craig and Scott have said all the way through this, English, no Russian needed at all. Everybody in this block of flats speaks, which is incredible, you know, because it's and they, I suppose, it's sort of like a priesthold. And Emma to a priesthold away from Ilya's men, so they need, and the saint is, you know, he's on the verge of hypo. Emma strips him off, and she strips him off, and using her body, she brings him from the brink of I suppose, a hypothermic coma. I mean, I'm never going to say no to a bit of Elizabeth Shue flesh. Just my love for this lady.
Yeah.
Can you guys still hear me, or am I completely talking to myself?
No. We can still hear you. I definitely heard, you know, up to the like you never turned down like
Elizabeth Shue thing. Yeah.
But no, I do think this is a kind of one of the most hilarious moments in the film, in terms of, like you said earlier, you know, about incredulous moments in this movie, and. Yeah, if somebody's having hypothermia, you know, like you, I mean, yeah, she did the first part, right? Of like you get the wet clothes off them, but then you swaddle them in dry blankets, warm. And if they can drink warm liquids, then, you know, like if they're conscious enough, then you can get some warm liquid into them. You do that too. You don't just take your top off and cuddle them. But that's what
I don't know. I mean, this, I have to disagree with you, Scott, because I think this dealt with cold fusion, so there's a lot of science behind this movie.
There is a lot of science behind this movie, so maybe Elizabeth Shue knows that. This, I mean, I've seen like a lot of action movies where there's been a lot of flimsy excuses to get female characters in a state of undress, but this is one of the flimsiest.
So they end up being basically an old Russian woman, again, as Wayne has pointed out, or any of us have now multiple times, yep, who speaks English. She sees them, yells that the Americans are in here, so the whole kind of hideout aspect doesn't really work. And they quickly rush out. He gets on some new clothes because he's perfectly fine now, apparently, after only a couple minutes. And then they rush up, they run up to the top of the building, and then is the one that actually wants to jump, and he is like, no, let's not do that. And
he stops from jumping because he has that, like, again, this is one of the few points in the movie where the start of the movie ties into it, and his tragic backstory ties into it, because he has a flashback to seeing Agnes dead.
And yet, well, maybe it's because Emma is with him, but he fell from a much higher distance.
Yeah, I did think
at
about
the beginning
that,
of the movie.
Yeah, yes. But then I thought, like, trying to give the movie some kudos, I thought, like, oh, maybe it's because, like, he loves this woman. He loved Agnes, a child love, you know, like, and that is what's triggered that. But yeah. But anyway, let's move on to more of this movie's weirdness. Because they climb down, down into the sewer, and then there is a sewer tour guide called Frankie, who acts as if she kind of knows Simon, but then doesn't actually know Simon. What is this character? Wow.
So she thinks, originally, it's like, oh, you're here to buy... It's like an underground black market art exhibit. She's like, oh, you're here to buy the art. And then he goes in there saying, no, we don't want your art. We want the maps. And that's basically the character. It's like they build up this whole thing with her that, oh, maybe she's going to be leading some underground, I don't know, revolutionary thing. Maybe it's going to be whatever else it could possibly be. She's like, oh, no, I have the maps. Okay, if you pay me, I'll kind of show you how to get to the U.S. Embassy. And then that's basically... She pops up later on, which we'll get to, but that's basically it for her. She takes them to one vent and says, okay, well, you have about 5 minutes before the water comes flushing in there, give or take. Like, what do you mean, give or take? Give or take a few minutes. And like, okay. And that's it. Like...
for Frankie. Does play a bit more of a role in the finale of the original cut. Not much more of a role. It's still a very strange, random character. Like you say, you think she's like the, because you're wearing like a red cap as all leftist revolutionary leaders wear. And you think she's got like a kind of faction going or something like that. But no, she's just like like selling black market art in a sewer with her one sidekick. Like I'm very confused by this whole character. I don't understand what's going on.
Yeah, so they open up, or well, they don't even open up the lid. He opens it up with his special, I don't even know what, I don't know if we've even mentioned it yet, his like lockpick that can do everything, his little gadget. He welds it open, or he like burns it open. They go in, and then they hear noise from the following people, and they're like, oh, somebody's coming, and then they just kind of shut it, and then it shows Simon and Emma walking through the sewer to the different openings, but unfortunately, the opening that they did need to get to is shut, so they have to go back. And that's, and as the water is about to rush, they are able to get out and to this, what, the one of the other latches, but they still end up right in front of the embassy.
Yes,
which doesn't make any sense because
I don't know. They still end up exactly where they wanted to end up, just apparently slightly less close to the U.S. embassy than they wanted to be. But anyway, he basically says, "Oh, if you can run into the U.S. embassy, because at this stage." Moscow is basically on the brink of revolution, as we mentioned, and everybody's scared. And the U.S. embassy is taking in all American citizens because the Russians are taking it against the Americans, and it's all kicking off. So he says, the U.S. embassy is just over there. It's about 100 yards. You can run that in 10 seconds, which is generous. I feel like that's pretty fine. That's like an athlete's pace, I think.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah.
Incredible she can do that with a dodgy heart.
Well, it turns out she might not have a dodgy heart. It turns out it might just be an anxiety, because like when she gets into the U.S. embassy, she's like, I've not taken my heart pills in a while. Ah, it seemed to be all right.
And so... Yeah, she starts running. He then makes sure to get himself caught, to which then he makes another offer saying, I know your dad is hiding billions of dollars, and I know where it's all at, and we can split it, you and I, but the son is kind of, he's not going to buy it. He's just going to kill him. And it comes with the other line I took from this whole movie was, you can't come to Russia without playing Russian roulette.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's putting one bullet in there. And there's, U.S. embassy soldiers. There's people all around. He's literally like in the middle of the street. They're just holding him down, pointing this gun at him, playing this game. And nobody is saying anything, I guess, because it's
Russia. Mean, he machine gunned down a police officer in the streets of Oxford earlier on in the movie. So...
And so he does it. He's about to fire again and says, but are you going to, or, tell me where this money is at? He's like, I know, but I'm not going to tell you, or something. He lights it up. The car blows up. And again, just like how Wayne was mentioning with the flash grenade, the car is kind of a far enough distance away, but it only seems to hurt
Ilya.
Ilya. It doesn't even hurt his men or anything that you could really tell. It doesn't hurt Simon. And Simon just kind of rushes off.
Yes. Although he rushes off, but he has enough time to stop and turn for a loving glance to Emma before then rushing off again.
Yeah. And she is protected by the only person of color in this movie who has the lines basically of, stand back, sir. I said, stand back, because he's the soldier. He says that to Ilya. And then, I don't know, he seems nice enough to her later on. But that's his entire role.
But yeah, he puts Ilya in his place. One of the few people that put Ilya in his place. So that's pretty interesting.
Yeah. But then they say to each other too during that point that there's the whole you found, which is supposed to have, you know, more meaning because of the romance or whatever, of, well, how will you find me? I'll find, or how will we meet again? Well, I'll find you because you found me. And then that's repeated about four times or more.
It's just right up there with Casablanca, isn't it, though?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's just lines from your history. Yeah. It's amazing.
So we've compared this movie to North by Northwest and Casablanca. So it's very good.
Yes.
This is interesting. So see when we see the after effect of Ilya's injuries. So he's like half his face has been scorched. And he's getting all kind of he's getting a scene to it by a doctor. Again, some very interesting production design choices of this movie, because like when he's in like a kind of doctor's chair, but he's in the headquarters of a van's mansion. While he's in the doctor's chair, he's in this room that also has an arcade machine where somebody is playing on the arcade machine, and for some reason, a massive Ku Klux Klan poster.
Well, I think it's one of those. It's one of those things where they're like, they're just maybe they want to make sure the audience knows that they're evil. It's one of those elements, like, oh, you might have been not known for sure up until this point of who the bad guys were, but trust us. These are really bad guys.
But in the previous scene, he shot a man in the chest at point blank range for telling a bad joke.
Yeah.
So we know they're bad guys.
Yeah.
Oh, that is true. That is true. We didn't mention that he, like, Ilya doesn't like sarcasm and just shot a man for sarcasm. So yeah, I'm pretty sure we're already convinced they're evil at this point.
Well, I don't know. I really needed to see the Ku Klux Klan poster to know for sure.
The Klan poster is what put over the top for you.
Yeah. I was like, oh,
are we sure they're bad guys? Can you imagine the production meeting? Can you just imagine the production meeting? Are we sure they're bad guys? Well, let's throw in some Third Reich, right wing memorabilia, so we just know they're bad guys. Yeah, do that.
Yeah. So the audience is watching going, oh, okay, now we know we're supposed to be rooting for Simon. God, you didn't. Following Ivan the whole time.
Yeah, but like it doesn't even make, like if they wanted to do that, you know, you'd think they would just have something like, oh, he has like a portrait of Stalin on his wall or something.
Yeah.
It seems so odd that a Russian billionaire villain had like collects Klan posters.
Yeah. So moving forward, what we end up
we can't go any further with that.
What we end up finding out is that the doctor that he's hired, kind of the professor, says that the cold fusion does not actually work. This is what we kind of learned earlier on, that at face value, it seems like it could, but once you get down into it, it doesn't. And Ivan is really upset about that and saying, well, what have I been paying you for all this money? But he says, no, wait, we can actually use that because we can make the now current president pay us for it and we'll say it actually works. So then when it doesn't work, then we can use that against him in staging our coup of that, well, he just wasted all this money on this research that didn't work while people are starving and they're freezing to death and everything else. So and Simon knows about that because he dressed as a Russian maid who apparently wears the hat and everything. And again, nobody... It's like, oh, I guess there's just this random house cleaner in here.
Yeah.
Right now, during this very, you know, secretive meeting that we're doing.
Which nobody pays attention to, because, like, in this meeting, you've got various Russian military generals,
yes,
Anovan and his son, Ilya. And Ilya is, again, probably the smartest person in this film, is the only person who questions, like, what's the maid doing there? That's a bit odd. You know, like, the only person who glances at the maid, who pays attention to the maid, who seems to realize it is probably Simon Templar.
Yeah. But he's been burnt a little bit, so he doesn't fight it enough.
Right. Yeah, now. He kind of passes it off as this kind of like, oh, maybe I'm just imagining things.
Which maybe if it stuck with the original ending and him turning on his father, that would make more sense, I guess. Why he would not pursue it more, but I don't. That's us giving too much into the movie. So
and kind of in between, yeah, just after this, he visits Emma, and he's doing his tombstone accent. He's doing like a kind of southern thing. He's like a southern FBI agent or something, and he drops off the we're kind of cutting between things of like so we see Ivan like selling it to the Russian president, the cold fusion, and Simon dropping off the kind of last piece of the equation, again talking to her as the southern guy and getting the kind of last piece of the equation.
Yes, and he sneaks it over to the professor and says, you know, that he needs a miracle. And this is another part where she...
Oh, yeah, this is where Frankie turns up again as well, because he gets this schematics of the presidential palace from Frankie.
Yeah. So, yeah, a lot happens in this where it's like him setting up all these, as you were saying, all these pieces. But he says to the professor, well, we need a miracle, because to be a saint, you need to have three miracles, which comes into the movie. And you have 12 hours, and here's the cold fusion, the final piece of the puzzle to make cold fusion. And yeah, it's basically all these lineups. You have him and Emma having this whole kind of relationship where it seems like she wants to know him more, but she said she does know him and she doesn't mind that he changes his name constantly or doesn't have a name. But then she's upset about, I don't know. I watched this whole part. Something's happening here to move the movie to the end, to the credits.
The wheels are in motion for the finale, which is not the big fiery finale that we talked about right at the start of the episode. Something very different indeed. And much more disappointing. But we move on. We get the schematics from Frankie, who, again, I need further explanation on her character, which I will never get. Anyway, we get to the presidential palace. And one of the interesting things about Simon Templar in this movie is he doesn't really he doesn't really kill people. He doesn't really do much actiony stuff. Like, he just... he's mainly, it's weird. He's presented, this is a weird thing about Simon Templar in this film. He's presented as if he's like James Bond, but then when you actually watch the actions and stuff and the amount of times he gets captured and beaten up, he's more like he's Sam Spade. It's just, it's a weird clash of presentation versus actual what is happening on the screen.
Yeah.
But the other thing is he doesn't really kill people in this movie, and even when he gets the chance to kill one of the guards, he's like, no, I've got the code of honor, so he just knocks him out with a chandelier, which may or may not have, you know, killed him anyway. But you know, this being a 12, he's probably just knocked out, you know. And again, like in all spy movies, if somebody is like good or quote-unquote innocent, then they don't die, you know, because like you know, James Bond can run over a police car with a tank and the two police officers will, you know, get out and brush themselves off. That's how these things work.
Yes. That's all it, yeah.
Anyway, he moves on. He manages to break into the president's bedroom and give the president the scoop and be like, you know what? What if Ancuzzi's involved? Just agree to it. And, you know, it'll all work out. And the prez is impressed. And he's like, okay, seems convincing to me.
Yes, he's a very trusting president, especially for somebody that just broke in and has been shot at by his soldiers. It doesn't take much convincing at all.
Well, he's very easily convinced in the cold fusion too.
Yes.
He was like, yeah, okay. I wasn't sure about giving you $10 billion, but now, actually, I know I've thought about it for 2 seconds because you were just about to walk out the room. I now am convinced to give you $10 billion. Yeah. Sorry. Thank you.
I'm going to fold into your bluff very easily.
So yeah,
the bit I love with Val Kilmer, with the saint breaking into the president's bedroom is, I mean, Russia have got such a lovely, warm relationship with Westerners, haven't they? And they're so trusting of us. So of course you're going to believe everything he says straight off the bat. You know, he's just broke in there, threw all your guards, and just give you this spiel on something, and you're just going to swallow it wholesale, because that's exactly what the Russia have been.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, everybody knows about the special relationship between America and Russia.
Wait, I thought we were all just two friendly superpower countries that got along perfectly.
Yeah. That's a long, long, long history of just being good old buddies.
Yeah. With nothing boiling under the surface at all.
Nothing, yeah. Nothing at all. No, no. Oh, dear.
So they get put up kind of in a trial where they're going to be basically executed or whatever in the public square. And again, this is a big kind of Russian broadcast, and Ivan is saying it in English, and you know, he's talking about the president gave all of the money into this cold fusion and it doesn't even work, and the president agrees with Simon, and so he goes, yes, I admit to it, and I back it, still to this day or whatever. And they're going to, it looks like it's not even going to work. And then the button is pressed and the cold fusion does work.
Dun, dun, dun. And again, this is one of the movie's many kind of half-hearted attempts at kind of being political, because like what we're getting is like a media savvy 90s update of like old school communist show trials. And, but it's like, so it's like, oh, we know our history kind of, but also don't care about this because action is maybe kind of, we're threatening actions going to happen. Yeah. Anyway, take us to the finale, Craig.
Okay. So, yeah. So then since apparently it does work, now everybody knows that Ivan is a criminal, even though it's not really said. Anybody could have just been like, oh, it doesn't even work, you know, to oppose it. But apparently that just proves he's a criminal. And so he is arrested. Same with Ilya. And they are then to be what you assume to be tried and put away. And, you know, you have all the Russian people so excited. You get to see Emma and the soldier are happy about it, and everybody's kind of congratulating her. And so during that time, we go to that, you know, Simon ends up finding Emma, and they kind of have this romantic meetup again, and he tells her his real name and that he wants her to say, I love you. She says, I love you. And he says, "Say I love you, Simon," basically. And she says it, and he's all happy about it. But he can never have a normal life. She's fine with that. But she's going to, there's something she has to do to so they can be completely free. And that is give cold fusion to all of the world, which she's going to go tell at a basically a big media press conference in England, at Oxford again. And she goes to do it. And before he or she is about to, he comes up to her again, and more romance stuff of her, him saying, "You should do it." And then they're all excited, I guess. So, yeah, so she's given the about to give the speech. And again, she sees the old the character where he played like the old British reporter. And he the that character sits down next to the detective who apparently has no idea, even though I believe that version of that character already popped up in their photographs before, or their stencil drawings.
I think so, yes. Yeah.
But yeah, he doesn't think anything about it, even though he's been chasing this man for so long. He's seen him.
2 years, apparently.
Yeah. He knows the eyes, the jaws, everything. He sits down right next to him. They even have a nice, lovely conversation. And then it isn't until the other detective is like, it's him. But by the time he turns, Simon has vanished, and they chase him through. They tackle the wrong person, and he gets to see Simon, who kind of gives him a little wink, driving off in a car. And during that time, you find out that it's basically an exposition wrap-up where there's a news report that talks about Ivan being arrested and also about all the oil that he was holding underneath his mansion, which I know comes up in the original ending, but it's not in this one. And that Simon even was able to sneak into Ivan's accounts and donate a lot of money to charities on Ivan's behalf, and also anonymously set up a whole cold fusion research foundation, basically. And that is it.
And we should mention before we kind of close the book on it, that news report on the radio is read out by the 1960s saint, who I just thought of as being the original saint, but found out that no, not so much. Roger Moore reads out that, and so that's a cameo, tying it back into the 60s series, and pretty much the only way it ties back into the 60s.
Yes.
Ah, it's here. So, before we head out on this one, do both of you want to give kind of your kind of final thoughts on the movie? Yeah. Wayne's final thoughts on the movie. Just
yeah.
I'd like to say to 17-year-old, you're a fucking idiot. You like this film? What's wrong with you? And my final note on this film, I made 60 notes on this film, and my final note is the end, which I think is my absolute final thought on this film. It's just a mess. Yeah. It's a complete car crash of a film, you know. And to be fair to, I've ripped Elizabeth Shue and I've ripped Val Kilmer a new arsehole right the way through this, but they're bringing at least a bit of charisma. At least they're trying their hardest. At least they're trying to, you know, bring a bit of spirit to this film, because everybody else involved, to be fair, Ilya as well, he's a decent threat, but it's just, you know, tonally it's all over the place, and it's just one of those films. It went on a minute going, "What the fucking hell did I just watch?" Because that's not the film I remember. Well, I don't remember the film.
No, I mean, I agree. I agree with that. I think, yeah, I think there's parts where Elizabeth Shue kind of loses some of that quirkiness or that eccentric behavior she had in the beginning, which I actually enjoyed. I thought that would be kind of more, I don't know, if there was more of a tension or between them, not necessarily, not, you know, obviously there's a straight sexual tension and that was it. But if there was kind of more of a give and take or something, maybe it would have created more dynamics. The accents are bad and these characters here he's playing are kind of going to borderline, like just stereotype, you know, German stereotype, whatever, Spanish stereotype, whatever it may be. But no, I agree with like Val Kilmer and Elizabeth Shue are at least charismatic. And no, to me, my biggest issue is that there's so many of these movies, again, throughout this podcast or whatever, that you watch, you're like, oh, well, if they just would have kept going in this direction, they could have done something really neat with it. Or which this one, it's because it's trying so many different things. It's such a kind of muddled mess. There wasn't one element that I could hold on to of saying, oh, if they just would have kept it in this, like they did in this scene particularly, it would have been great. Like every single scene, it seems like for every part that has something decent, like at the same exact time, there's something that then works against it. So it's interesting. As I said, it's one that had me kind of shaking my head of like, is this really happening the whole time?
I very much feel the same way. Chiming with both you guys of like, you know, as much as the romance can drag at certain points in the movie, Elizabeth Shue and Val Kilmer are the best things in the movie. Yet Val Kilmer's accents are often terrible, but like he is charismatic and I love his smug faces throughout. And you know, there is a genuine kind of sexual tension between him and Elizabeth Shue. There's real sexual chemistry, and as we've kind of talked about before on this podcast, that's actually relatively rare for an action hero, because like lots of action heroes, be it Stallone or Schwarzenegger or Seagal or a lot of these guys, or like more modern ones like Vin Diesel, never have any sexual chemistry with any of their leading ladies. So kudos on that. So there's that. And it's an oddly watchable film. Even though it kind of fails at everything it's doing, it does not have enough action to be a spy action adventure. It does not have enough depth to be a political thriller. It doesn't have enough gags to be the crime caper it wants to be sometimes. It seems to fail in all directions. But yet, because it's such a mess, it is oddly watchable. And yeah, some of the decision making in terms of production design and stuff like that is like so wacky that you, it keeps you kind of just like, well, baffled and but also kind of watching and entertained in some way. I'll keep bringing it up. Who is the character of Frankie? Why is she selling underground art in a sewer? Like, who set up this rat club that serves dishes of money and is also a brothel? What is going on? Why do people have clan posters? You know, all these things. You know, these are the things that kept me entertained throughout the movie. And some of the movies we've covered that are just kind of bad movies, and we're just kind of going like, well, yeah, this didn't work, that didn't work. At least this is a mess in such a weird way that I was kind of entertained throughout, despite it clearly not being a good movie in any way.
Yeah. No, we kind of all agree, but I would say, thinking about it as, you know, you were just talking, Scott, I think what would almost have made it work is, you know, you have something like Mission Impossible and the direction it went, where if you just almost did a tongue-in-cheek again, where you just made it so, where you, oh, what would have happened in the, so in the 90s, you know, you had stuff like, this is a comedy, but the Brady Bunch movie or the Addams Family movie, where it kind of added adult themes and it kind of, poked fun, the Brady Bunch movie, it poked fun at the TV show while kind of honoring it. And so I wonder if it just kind of embraced its silliness more or embraced all of that stuff more, maybe it could have been something that would be really fun. But I'm sure at that time, studios didn't want to put a lot of money into something that would have been, you know, basically a parody of a...
I was very conscious of the fact that this film came out in the same year as Austin Powers. Like, that was a thought that kept coming back to me, you know, because, like, it sometimes it does seem like a parody or a spoof.
Yes.
Yeah, I wonder if it's if the Saints really is suffering with that fatigue that happened at that point. You know, you had so many of the 60s revival and nostalgia trips that were coming through. You know, Mission Impossible, The Addams Family, like you say, The Man from Uncle, which wasn't made for another 10, 15 years, but the script was around in Hollywood at that time. I'm sure the script was around from like 95 before it landed on Guy Ritchie's table, like many years later. You know, as well as stuff like, you know, you had Lost in Space, you know, that was a 60 revival.
Yeah, it came out in 98.
They redid The Prisoner, the 60s TV show. They did that with Jim Caviezel, you know.
That's right. I remember that.
Well, I mean, nobody cared about The Avengers being remade, but they did it anyway. It feels like a bandwagon moment, doesn't it? You know, well, Tom Cruise has come out and done Mission Impossible, and they made a fuck ton of money, and that film was a bit of a mess. So, and it just feels like they just went out and whatever intellectual property they could get their hands on and push out as fast as everybody else they did. And I don't think they really understood, like you've alluded to, Scott, I don't think they really got to the bones of what The Saint is and the history of The Saint. They just come up with a clever story and it was too clever for its own good, if we're honest. You know, it was, there's some heavy, like you say, there's some heavy themes in there, and it's not one thing or the other, it's all of them in a blender, and it's all thrown at the wall, and whatever sticks to the wall is what you get. That's sort of how I feel about the film.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, like you're saying about, like, them not really kind of getting to the nitty-gritty of, like, what The Saint's about. I was reading in the IMDb trivia, and it was also on, you know, like, that apparently Val Kilmer met Roger Moore at Cannes and kind of said to him, "Oh, well, we messed that up then, didn't we?" And he kind of, Roger Moore was like, "Oh," trying to clarify, and he's like, you know, and then he was like, "Oh, well," talking about the film, and he's like, Roger Moore was like, "What do you mean?" And basically, Val Kilmer said, "Oh, well, after we wrapped, you know, I went back and read some of the stories, and there's some real good stories there." And so in retrospect, Val was obviously less than impressed.
Brilliant. So you're dealing with an intellectual property you don't understand. It's fantastic.
Yeah, true. But I mean, like, I can see why they probably thought they had a home run. You know, Elizabeth Shue, only a couple years after, Leaving Las Vegas.
Yep.
You know, Val Kilmer is still kind of hot. You know, Philip Noyce, you know, he had just a couple years before done, like, Clear and Present Danger. So he'd done, like, a, you know, two Jack Ryan films. So that seems kind of cool. I mean, they've got Philip Mahou, who was a cinematographer on GoldenEye. They've also got Terry Rollins, who was the editor on GoldenEye. You know, like, it all seems like they've got, like, a kind of all-star team together, but it's just like, it didn't work out.
Yeah.
Mm.
Oh, one last thing I do want to mention before we really close the book on this episode. We've talked a little bit about it before, about kind of hip 90s soundtracks of movies that don't need to have a hip soundtrack. Now, this is a big action adventure spy blockbuster, which is not, you know, not something you necessarily associate with having a hip soundtrack, you know, that kind of thing. You know, it's usually more mainstream. But I just want to read out some of the acts. Now, there's some big acts on the soundtrack. So you've got the likes of David Bowie. You've got the likes of Duran Duran. But also, and this doesn't make sense because it's a Hollywood picture, is you've just got, like, loads of dance acts who are, like, popular in the UK at the time. You know, like, so you've got Orbital. You've got the Sneaker Pimps. You've got Dread Zone. You've got Daft Punk, who were not popular in the States for about 8 or 9 years after this film came out. You got Underworld, you got the Chemical Brothers. Even Movie is probably bigger in the UK at this point than he is in the US. Yeah. You know, like, and then other kind of acts like Everything But the Girl and Luscious Jackson, who are kind of like, you know, again, kind of cult acts. It's a very interesting soundtrack.
Yeah, just as you said, it, my note 31 is it's where the car chase happens in Oxford, and I put this is exactly as I wrote it. I suddenly realised the soundtrack was curated by an absolute idiot. Whatever 90s note at the time is on the playlist.
Oh dear. Yeah, but like I just like no, it's like, it's interesting that this is a Hollywood film, and yet the soundtrack seems entirely aimed at a UK audience because it's mostly dance acts, British dance acts that and again dance or EDM as Americans call it, yes, was not popular at the time in the 90s in the US, so it doesn't make any sense at all.
Yeah, I mean we started having because it's only on in movies basically, so it was they weren't popular, but then there would be a ton of there would be big in not movies not like this, so it'd be as movie that didn't necessarily do well until The Matrix later on, but you know, where you'd have things like Hackers or things that were like cyber, you know, what is it, cyber thrillers or whatever they were called,
yeah,
where they would fit in that sense. But yeah,
Obviously, the soundtrack was made by a British dance enthusiast, yes, who happened to be on the production. I think we've probably said everything we can say about 1997's The Saint. And that brings this film to a close, pretty much this season to a close. So just as we head on out, if you want to give plugs and kind of social media details, and we'll go with Wayne first.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Thanks very, very much to Scott and Craig for asking me back again. I've had a blast talking about The Saint. Even though it's not the greatest film in the world, it was still very much enjoyable, and the notes I made and critically watching this film was a lot of fun. You can find me on Twitter at £1 Movie Pod. You can find me on Facebook at the £1 Movie Podcast, and you can find me on podcast, you know, streaming things, wherever you get your podcasty downloads from. Just put the £1 Movie Pod. Come on, we'll watch some B-movie trash and some Oscar winners and talk about them and see what I've got for a pound. That's basically it. Yes, and thank you very much, guys, for asking me on again.
That's no problem. It's not a problem at all. It's good to have you back on. It's been a lot of fun. Yeah. And the Tombstone episode we did with you was a lot of fun, too. So, Craig, do you want to give the usual details that you give?
Sure. If you want to find me, as Scott mentioned, I am one third of the Bloodhound Picks, PIX podcast. You can find us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, or our website, just bloodhoundpicks.com, or, you know, bloodhoundpicks, all one word. And with that podcast, we look at usually older, obscure, or independent horror films that we'll just quickly highlight. And we'll also sometimes interview, you know, members of the independent horror community, be it bloggers, filmmakers, comic book artists, whatever it may be. We just will talk to them about what it is like trying to continue on with this art in the modern age, and especially during this pandemic. And then if you'd like to follow me personally, my name is, it's under Craig Dram, D-R-A-H-E-I-M. And that's on, I think, Twitter is just Craig Dram. Instagram is craig.dram. And that is, yeah, that's me.
And if you want to hear more of my voice, you can on my fortnightly interview show, New Horror Express. New Horror Express also has a spin-off show, the Guilty Pleasure Podcast, where me and a guest will look at some of 21st century horror's guiltiest pleasures. And you can find that on the website, newhorrorexpress.com. You find us on Twitter at newhorrorexpressexp. And you can also find us on Facebook. If you want to hit me up directly, you can at scottmurphy85. And if you want to hit this show up, you can on Twitter as well at 90s_all. And basically, if you want to rate, review, and subscribe to us wherever you get podcasts, whether that be the likes of Apple Podcasts or Spotify, please do that. And if you are reviewing the show, if you can please give the show 5 stars, that would be great, because if you give us less than 5 stars, then the algorithm thinks that we're shit. And yeah, you don't want to do that, because that's not supporting the show. So so don't piss off the algorithm gods. That's not what we want. So 5 stars. Thanks again. But really, that is the end for this one. Please do join us again next week, when we will be talking about Mission Impossible. Until then, though, see ya.